I want to welcome you to a Sunrise online worship experience. My name is Amy and I'm one of the pastors here. We're so glad that you've taken this time to set aside to worship and glorify and just spend time with our Savior and with our church family together. You might notice that today, the worship experience that you're participating in might look a little bit different. That's because the numbers have spiked and we are trying to take extra precautionary measures this week and not do our live in-person worship circle, but respect that we want to do our part to try to help keep those hospital beds open. And so we just are so grateful for each one of you and then pray that the Lord is present and near wherever you are worshiping today. If you have a moment, I invite you to share this worship experience on Facebook. Wherever you're worshiping, just let us know that you are worshiping with us by texting your name to the number that you see below. And if you've never texted that number before to let us know you're worshiping with Sunrise, we invite you to use the keyword connect and text the word connect so that we can begin to get to know you and connect with you. I invite you now to join with me in a moment of prayer. God, we come to you and we invite you to break into our space where we are and to break into our hearts and to break into our lives. And God, that this time that we spend with you, Lord, that you would fill us up, refresh us, renew us, challenge us, teach us, make us more and more and more like you. And I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. I invite you now to sing and praise God and worship with us.
I count on one thing, the same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God who never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me. Same God, he's never late. He's working all things out, working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. tears as you set me free. Thoughts of peace given straight to me, straight to move on, straight to move on. I wonder why my fears could hold me down, because your unrelenting love has me found. Your blood has set me free. You won the victory. Yeah. When I get run down, when my shame's abound, in the middle of the storm, I'm ready. Yeah. I lean on your my darkest hour, in the middle of the storm, I'm ready, yeah. In the middle of the storm, I'm ready, yeah. I know you go before me, so I let you lead. God, I know your love will not forsake me, so I'll give you all my troubles. I'll give you all this world, all the evils and the darkness will run and flee, for you have overcome, and you won the victory. My shame's unbound, in the middle of the storm, I pray to you. I lean on your power, in my darkest hour, in the middle of the storm, I pray to you. When I get run down, when my shame's unbound, in the middle of the storm, I pray to you. I lean on your power, in my darkest hour, in the middle of the storm, I pray to you. In the middle of the storm, I pray to you. In the middle of the storm, I pray to you. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of a spirit, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. I invite you to join your hearts in prayer together with me. Lord, we take this moment to breathe in and to breathe out in gratitude for the gift of life that you have given us. I thank you for the gift of silence, the gift of your presence that is the sure foundation, that is our stable anchor and our rock, no matter what is happening in our world around us, even in our own heads sometimes. God, remind us that we always have instant access to your Holy Spirit, to your presence, with just a conscious act of turning our thoughts and our attention in prayer to you. What a huge privilege, what a huge gift, and we don't take it for granted. Lord, teach us and remind us that the gift of your presence is there at any time we need it, that we can continue, God, to be growing in our faith, to be growing in our likeness of you, and to be growing in our ability, God, to spend time with you and to see you working in our midst. We pray, God, with all our hearts for those among our church family that are experiencing loss and sickness and loneliness. And God, we say their names out loud wherever we are right now and cry their names out to you, God, that you would be with them and be near them and touch them and bring healing and wholeness and restoration to each and every one. And Lord, we pray together the prayer that you taught us to pray by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Everything that we do in and around Sunrise Church, we do because we are called to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the healing and transformation of the world. And right now, my friend JJ has two opportunities for each of us to grow in our discipleship.
Thank you, Pastor Amy.
Well, like she said, I'm JJ, and I mean, we're family. I'm with you. You know what? Can you feel it? I mean, really. Feel it. Thanksgiving is like almost here. And then with that, as soon as you get through digesting comes Christmas. And it occupies all of your time thinking about what's coming up. With that comes a lot of Christmas discipleship opportunities. And it is gonna be cool because if the stress of the Christmas season isn't enough, then let's add the year 2020 into the mix, for crying out loud. And when the stress dominates our lives, somewhere along the way, we've lost our ability to trust God. Our faith can be an invaluable resource to help manage these stressors. So learn more during our Advent teaching series called Keeping It Real, which starts next weekend. And then, when the Advent season starts, we know that Christmas Eve is also just around the corner. Circumstances might be different for many of us this year for many reasons. But rest assured, our worship planning team has been working nonstop to intentionally create some amazing online and in-building Christmas Eve worship opportunities for both you and your family. So make sure you stay connected with us during these next few weeks as we prepare to share some exciting ways for you to celebrate Jesus' birth, and it's all based on your own comfort level. Right now is about to become this most amazing time in everybody's heart when you prepare yourself to give back just a taste of what God's given us. So with that, here's Pastor Amy.
Thank you so much, JJ. And we have in our society right now, like, two different lived realities. While some of us are rushing around and getting ready for a Thanksgiving holiday and to celebrate the birth of our Savior with our family, others of us are experiencing tremendous loneliness and tremendous loss and the inability to gather with our families this year. Perhaps trudging through the holidays, just waiting for the new year to be ushered in for hopes of a brighter future. Here is one way that you can be a beacon of hope to others. Simply go to the link you see on the screen and fill out the form, and Sunrise will reach out on your behalf to see how we can bring hope in a season of uncertainty. This is our holiday outreach, and that's what the church is all about. We want to be connecting and reaching out to anybody who is experiencing any kind of those feelings of loss or loneliness this season. So let us know who you might know that might need that extra boost this season. And another way that you can continue to share in the community of faith and believers and give of your time and resources is through just our ongoing generosity. And so I wanted to let you know that there are several ways that you can continue supporting the mission of God and the ministries of Sunrise here. And that is by texting your giving in to the number that you see there. You just simply text the amount that you are wanting to give, or you could also go to the website, sunrisefamily.org, and click on the tithe and offering and go ahead and do a secure web payment that way. And the other way is that you can go ahead and mail a check, a physical check, to our address that you see listed there. In any case, we thank you so much for how you are continuing to support the ministries and missions out of your faithfulness to God and making a difference in our church and in our community. And I am so excited to learn what God has for us as Pastor Jim teaches us today more about our Behind Closed Doors sermon series.
Thank you, Pastor Amy. And yes, I'm excited because we are in the second and final week of our teaching series, Behind Closed Doors. While it was a quick series, we had an opportunity to explore kind of inside of us and help us determine what steps we can take as we move forward in becoming a more devoted and committed follower of Jesus Christ, working on our discipleship. So this week, we're going to be taking a look at from the inside of us out. Now, last week, we talked about what it looked like from the outside coming in. Jesus called out the Pharisees that they were good looking on the outside, and they were all polished and had the appearance, the image of being righteous and holy. But Jesus said on the inside, they were anything but. So as we flip it today, we're going to be looking from the inside back out and what we see in ourselves. Now, what is on the inside of us is often reflected our outward actions and our reactions. What is harbored or buried behind our closed doors, friends, are the true essence of who we are. No matter what we may display on the outside, when push comes to shove, when the challenges of life pile up, when the stressor red valve hits max, we can explode. We unleash the person that is inside of us. So let me ask you, what kind of person is residing behind your closed doors? No, don't go over and comment on that. Just save that for yourself. Save it for an opportunity for you to have an individual time of self-reflection and introspection. But at the same time, don't forget. Don't set it aside. Don't gloss over your need to own up to who you are on the inside. Don't downplay the potential damage you can cause when an unhealthy person resides behind your closed doors. Don't dismiss the opportunity or the power available for transformation, transforming your inside so that your outside reflects Jesus in you. Now, remember, you can snow me, you can snow your loved ones, you might even snow yourself, but you can't fool God. God already knows our inside, knows it better than we know ourselves. And God's Word has this uncanny ability to challenge and convict us, to stop us in our tracks, to cause us to pivot on a moment's notice. One of those places in Scriptures is found in Hebrews, the 4th chapter. It's in the New Testament, toward the end of the book, one of the ends of Paul's writings. And we're going to read from Hebrews 4, a couple verses beginning with number 12. God's Word is alive and working and is sharper than a double-edged sword. It cuts all the way into us, where the soul and the spirit are joined, to the center of our joints and bones. And it judges the thoughts and the feelings in our hearts. Verse 13, nothing in all the world can be hidden from God. Everything is clear and lies open before Him. And to Him we must explain the way we have lived. In our relationship with God, God sees what is behind our closed doors. So as a fully committed, faithful follower of Jesus, we are called to be in the world, but not of the world. We are called to be the light of Jesus into a world of darkness. We are called to bring hope to the hope depleted. And we can only do that when Jesus has been given full occupancy behind our closed doors. Now, 2020 has been many, many things. A year of challenges, of struggles, of battles, of conflicts, of uncertainties, of irritations and inconveniences, of disappointments, frustrations, and tough, tough decisions. And if I've left something out of that list, that's what you can put over in the comments section, is what 2020 has been for you this year. Now, friends, how we choose to handle a 2020-like year is a direct reflection of who we are and what resides inside of us. Now, the Bible is filled with lots of examples of what people have allowed their inner self to become. In the Sermon on the Plain, which is Luke's version of Matthew's Sermon on the Mount, in a very straightforward manner, Jesus outlines the options available to us, complete with both rewards and instructions mixed in his instructions. And when he does that, it is left to our own choosing which we will follow. So I invite you to listen carefully to Jesus's instructions, hear what Jesus would do and what Jesus would have us do as well. We're in Luke 6, second book in the New Testament, right after the book of Matthew, or after the book of Mark, third book, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We're in the 6th chapter, verse number 35. Hear these words carefully. Jesus says, love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward from heaven will be very great. And you will truly be acting as a child of the Most High. For He is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. Verse 36, you must be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. Verse 37, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it will all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Verse 38, give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back. Verse 39. Then Jesus gave the following illustration. Can one blind person lead another? Won't they both fall into a ditch? Verse 40. Jesus said, students are not greater than their teacher, but the teacher who is fully trained will become like the teacher. Verse 41. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? Verse 42. How can you think of saying, friend, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite! First, get rid of the log in your own eye, then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Now, over the last couple weeks, we have used the word hypocrite a few times. So I want to give you a good working definition of it. A hypocrite is a person who puts on religious behavior in order to gain attention, approval, or admiration from others. It's kind of like a religious narcissist, wanting all the attention, all the glory, but not wanting to put any of the work into it. Verse 43 goes on to say that no good tree bears bad fruit, nor does a bad tree ever bear good fruit. Verse 44, every tree is recognized by its own fruit. People do not pick figs from thorn bushes or grapes from briars. Verse 45, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart. And an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. I read these words and I realize, friends, that I have a long, long way to go to be more like Jesus. Jesus' words remind me, reminds us that our speech and our actions and our reactions reveal our deep seated beliefs. It unveils our true attitudes and exposes our real motives behind our closed door lives. Every day, you and I are faced with a mountain of decisions. Some are small and seemingly insignificant and maybe only affect ourselves. And other decisions that come before us can be large, humongous. They're monstrosities, and they have the potential to affect lots of other people. People that we love or people that we may never meet. Who and what resides behind our closed doors can and will directly affect the decisions that we make. Now, if you're old like me, you can probably remember the grassroots movement back in the 1990s that was summed up in the letters WWJD. Yeah, what would Jesus do? Now, WWJD was actually based on a book called In His Steps, written by a guy named Charles Sheldon way back in 1896. So almost 100 years after it was written, it became popular again. Now, if you were one of the 500 plus million people who happened to buy Sheldon's book and read In His Steps, I would love for you to put that over in the comments section. I wonder how many of us are out there that are WWJD people. Now, the book and the movement simply promoted the biblical idea that before every decision we make, large, small, or in between, we should stop and we should ask, what would Jesus do? I can't help but wonder what Jesus would do in 2020. Demands for decisions abound almost daily. Actions and reactions are everywhere. Thoughts, opinions, nuances, feelings, ideas all flow freely and flow at times unbridled, unsolicited, and sometimes unwelcomed. Just when I think I've got it figured out, at least from my perfect angle, from my perspective that validates what I want to think, I'm reminded of the Apostle Paul challenging the believers in the city of Corinth when they were faced with a decision that influenced and affected lots of other people, especially young people in their faith. This is what Paul writes to that church in southern Greece. What he writes to them, challenging them to be thoughtful in their actions and realize how their words, their actions, and reactions can affect people. 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, verse number 23. I have the right to do anything, you say, but nothing is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. Verse 24, no one should seek their own good, but the good of others. How do our actions and reactions, how do our words benefit others and not just ourselves? Those are sobering words from Paul, and they remind me that in all things, it is not at all about me. So the real question is, in everything big or small, what would Jesus do? Yet even before we can answer that question, there's an even bigger question to consider. Does Jesus have fully and completely residency behind your closed doors? Is Jesus the one that occupies the space in your heart? If no, friends, then let's talk, let's pray, and together let's consider Jesus for your life. Now, if you said yes, well, then do you remember Jesus' mission statement? No, it's not Matthew 28. That's the church's mission statement. But Jesus had a more personal mission statement that he lived by during his time on earth. And it's very simply this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Friends, is that the mission statement that lines the walls behind your closed doors? If not, what is it? And how could it ever equal what Jesus' mission statement is for us? To love God and to love our neighbor. If we're going to make decisions that make a difference in people's lives, then Jesus needs to be the one that informs us. So we need to change, if we haven't, who we put our allegiance in. We need to change to Jesus. Let us pray. God, as we come this day, as we seek again the power of your holy word speaking to us, as we lift up words from the sermon on the plain where Jesus gives us instructions, as we let the words from Corinthians soak into us that yes, we need to be thinking of others, then Lord, help us, help each of us identify where we are. Help us to throw open the door that protects us and allow you in. Whatever is in there and residing, whatever comes out when we are stressed or angry or uncertain, let that be removed and let it be filled with you, Jesus. We pray that in your loving and holy name. Amen. Now, if you were one of those folks that might have said no, that Jesus isn't quite there yet, then we've got a great song that will help you think about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And it's an invitation. Invitation for you now during the song, but an invitation for you to invite Jesus into your heart. We simply invite you to come to the altar.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. The Father's arms are
Friends, I hope you had an opportunity during that song to experience not only the words, but the invitation. The invitation to come with arms wide open. Because when we open our arms before God, we make ourselves vulnerable. And we open up those doors that we try so desperately to keep open. And we allow God to come in and fill the emptiness. So that when we do look from the inside out, what people see on the outside, our actions and our reactions and our words truly are a reflection of Jesus Christ inside of us. Now, as we prepare ourselves for the week ahead to put this into practice, I have a couple discussion questions, a couple opportunities for you to grow in your discipleship. And so I would encourage you to consider these in your worship circles, in your small groups, whoever you may gather with this week, an opportunity to come and just worship God through discussion is a great way to grow in your faith. So here's the first question. Reflecting on Luke 6, what one instruction from Jesus do you need to focus on cultivating in your life? Second thing to consider, describe your process of decision making. Who or what is your go-to source of reference? Now, don't just say Jesus because that's the obvious answer, but really think about that. Who do you rely upon? What do you rely upon as the basis for your decision making? A couple great questions that you can wrestle with this week. Be sure after our prayer to hang around. Got a great family ministry video. It gets to focus on the blessing of what we have. A great opportunity for this season of Thanksgiving. So my friends, now receive God's blessing for us as we conclude our time of worship and prepare for our time of service and witness. God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Let us open the doors of our heart so that what is on the outside is on the inside, and what's on the inside is reflected on the outside, and both of those places are occupied by you, Jesus, in our heart. We pray that in your name. Amen.
The Bible, it's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. And now for an amazing story, inspired by the book of Matthew, chapter 20, verses 1 through 15.
While Jesus taught in many different ways, he often shared the most important truths as stories. He used the things and animals and situations in people's everyday lives to help them understand things that were bigger. One day, Jesus explained to his closest friends what the kingdom of heaven was like, and he used a story to help it connect. Now, if he told that story to us today in our world right now, I think it would go a little something like this. There once was a man who owned a large vineyard.
Here at Grape Escape Vineyards, we specialize in red, white, and green grapes.
One bright autumn day, the man called in his manager to find out how his harvest was doing.
It's doing great.
Thanks a bunch. We shall pick the grapes immediately before the beetles nibble them up.
That's some good raisinin'.
The next morning, the vineyard owner rose while it was still dark and hurried to the center of town. He arrived at around 6 a.m. and there were people still standing around noshing on grape jelly muffins.
Are you looking for work?
Yes, indeed. How much do you pay?
$100 for the day.
Precisely perfect. Let us proceed.
The owner led the workers back to his vineyard.
Baskets, hats, don't squash the grapes.
Oh, what happens if we do that?
They might whine a little.
The vineyard owner wanted to be sure that the beetles wouldn't ruin his precious grape harvest, so around 3 hours later at 9 o'clock, he returned to the town center and found more people lined up for work.
You come pick grapes for me. I'll pay you well.
Good deal. Let's go.
The workers were all picking as fast as they could, but there were still long rows to harvest, so the vineyard owner went back to the town center at 12 o'clock noon, 3 hours later, and there were still plenty of workers standing around.
Come, help out in my vineyard.
And after the new set of workers had worked for 3 hours, the vineyard owner returned to the town square again at 3 o'clock.
Need some more grape pickers, you in?
The blazing sun beat down as the vineyard owner added the new workers to his crew. One of the men hired at dawn wiped sweat off his face as he sipped his water.
Showing up for work in the afternoon? What a terrible work ethic.
The first workers returned to picking grapes, filling basket after basket. But even though it was still 5 o'clock, the vineyard owner returned to the town square where he still found plenty of people hanging around counting cockroaches and looking bored.
Why have you been standing here all day?
No one, hired us.
I'll hire you. Come work in my vineyard.
For the final hour of the workday, everybody pitched in. Whew! As the last baskets of grapes were brought up, the owner called to his manager.
Just look at all these beautiful grapes, all freshly harvested.
A great job, if I do say so.
Pay the workers. Start with the ones I hired last of all.
So the manager pulled out his cash box and lined up the workers. He started with the ones who only picked grapes for an hour.
Here you go, $100.
Totally rad, man.
At the other end of the line, the workers who began at dawn began doing some quick math.
$100 for 1 hour of work. That means we're about to get over $1,000.
The manager continued to hand out pay packets to the workers who started at 3 o'clock.
$100.
And noon.
$100.
And 9 o'clock in the morning.
$100?
Huh. Okay.
By the time the workers who started at 6 a.m. reached the front of the line, they were getting a little bit, worried.
You're paying us what's fair for working all day, right?
Yep. $100.
What? Preposterous.
The early morning workers stalked off to find the vineyard owner.
You paid those hooligans who only worked an hour the same as us, even though we sweated all day picking your grapes. Just look at this crispy sunburn.
Fred, didn't you agree to $100 for the whole day?
That is a technicality.
Do you feel cheated because I gave so freely to the other workers? Don't I have a right to do what I want with my own money?
But it's not fair.
Take your money and go. I want to give the ones I hired last the same pay I gave you.
The early workers glared and skulked away, cash in hand. They had let the owner's generosity to someone else ruin their day. Jesus' story made it clear. God gives freely to everyone. Rather than focusing on what you don't have, adjust your attitude. Choose to look at what you do have.